We're now looking at topic 19, Principles for Ministry Among Muslims. And we're going to turn to the scriptures here, 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter chapter 3. We will not take time to read the passage, but I'm going to refer to verses in this passage one by one as we go down through and just make comments on characteristics which are important for a church that wants to seriously engage in ministry and in presence and in witness among Muslim people. And by the way, in our readings, this would come from chapter 14 in this book, The Way of Christians and Muslims, and chapter 24 in the dialogue. The first principle we see in verse 8 of chapter 3 is live in harmony with one another. I know that the Christian movement is very diverse. Our Muslim friends often point that out. And like I say to them, we celebrate our diversity. We love our diversity. It's a sign of the richness of the gospel. However, when that diversity means that we have no relationship with one another, I think that does distort the fruitfulness, the effectiveness of our witness. And I'm a guest in your midst, and so forgive me if what I'm saying is not helpful. But for example, it would seem to me that the Protestant communities in a region which is predominantly Orthodox should attempt to develop some helpful relationships with the Orthodox community. When I was living in Lithuania, there was no Muslims around. It was a secular society. But working there at the Lithuania Christian College as academic dean, I met with the Orthodox Archbishop several times. To develop a relationship, to develop trust, in fact, invited an Orthodox priest to come and meet with the students on occasion. And in my class on theology, when students would say, oh, the church is so divided, you're just all split up, all so divided. I say, we're diverse, but we also seek to respect one another. And I have personally met with the Orthodox Archbishop several times to talk about trust building between the Protestant community, which I represent, and the Orthodox community that he represents. And it was a trust building exercise. We both believe that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior, and in filling and work of the Holy Spirit, it behooves us to demonstrate that reality by cultivating some relationships, some helpful relationships. So live in harmony with one another. And the local congregation, if a local congregation is filled with tension, it's very, very difficult for the Holy Spirit to work with freedom. Or if you are involved in a missionary team and the team is not working in harmony, it is very difficult for the Holy Spirit to work freely and effectively. So in a repentant spirit, let's really be committed to harmonious relationships. That's the first thing he says here. Live in harmony with one another. And then he goes on in verse 8 to say also, be humble. Don't walk with arrogance. Sometimes in conversation with Muslims, we Christians can be so arrogant. You know, I know my sins are forgiven, but you don't know that. You know, so arrogant. If I know my sins are forgiven, it is absolutely because of God's grace. It is not at all because of anything I have done. And so we say in our confession of faith and confession of our experience with Christ, with utmost humility and great joy, I who am so unworthy bear witness that I am a forgiven sinner. And I'm so grateful for that. We seek to bear witness in a spirit of humility appropriate to the gift of grace that has been given to us. Paul writes to the Ephesians that even the good that we do is by his grace, not that we should boast about the good things that we do. Walk in humility. Verse 9, he says, do not repay evil with evil or insult with insult, but with blessings, because to this you were called, so that you may inherit a blessing. So bless those who do you wrong. when a pastor in Tajikistan was killed, we all know that story, while he was in his early morning prayers in his church. And by sunset, his wife had said to the nation on television and radio, "I have forgiven the one that did this. In fact, in the name of Jesus, I wish to bless him." My. What a witness to that whole nation. Now granted, he must be brought to justice and all of that, but in her heart she had forgiven. Bless those that do you wrong. I mentioned to you my involvement in Indonesia, where there has been violence, and it's been both sides, Christians and Muslims, in violent encounter with each other in Central Java. Back just over 10 years ago, 1998, this happened. And how one wing of the Islamic, most Muslims in Indonesia, the vast majority, are very peace-loving. It's a very gentle society. But there's one stream called Hezbollah. It's not the Lebanese Hezbollah. It's Indonesian Hezbollah, which has been violently involved in burning churches and confronting pastors and so forth. It has been very, very difficult. And how this dear young pastor went to the home of the Hezbollah commander and knocked on the door and said, and the commander says, "Who are you? You know, if you are a Christian, you're an infidel, and I can deal with you." And the pastor said, "I've come to ask you a favor. I would love to have a cup of tea with you." And then for the next couple years, going to that home regularly for tea. And then he invited the commander to go with him and his officers, the Hezbollah officers, to go together with Christian pastors to Banda Aceh, where the tsunami had hit. And the Christian churches were very involved in reconstructing up there in the tsunami hit area, although it was a 100% Muslim area, almost 100% Muslim area, and a militant expression of Islam. But there are the Christians helping. And this pastor says, "You should also be there with us, you know, working side by side with us in the reconstruction." And they accepted this invitation, went together up there to Banda Aceh. And for 2 weeks, the pastor roomed with his commander, who some months ago had said, "I can deal with you because you're a Christian." And they became friends. And one night, sitting around the campfire, this commander begins to weep around the cooking fire. And he says, "I'm weeping because when I think what our hands have done to you and how you reciprocate with this kind of love and blessing us in this way, my heart has just melted within me." And now, I told you about the launching of the dialogue and so forth and the conversations we had with the commander and how the pastor, sitting beside the commander, was patting him on the shoulder while he was weeping again because he said, "This book, this dialogue, shows another way of relating to each other, not violently, but respectfully. And now, in Indonesia, there in Java, if the commander becomes aware that there's consideration by some of his lieutenants somewhere burning another church, he gets in touch with the pastor, says, "We have work to do. Let's work together at extinguishing that fire." And I asked the pastor, "How could this happen?" He says, "Lots of cups of tea and the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit." He calls us here to build peacemaking bridges. Bless those who do you wrong, you see. Keep your tongue from evil. Now, oftentimes, in our conversation about Muslims, or the Muslim conversation about us, our tongues are used to speak evil of the other. And I just hope and pray that in this seminar, that I have, by God's grace, refrain from speaking evil about Islam. That's my commitment. I just want to say to you and to Muslims who may hear what I shared here, if I have spoken untruly or unkindly about Islam, forgive me, please, and write to me about it. Because I want to take this teaching very seriously, not to speak evil about my Muslim friends, you see, to use my tongue to speak good. Now, surely there's things within the Muslim movement that are not good. Some things are terrible. And there's things within the Christian movement that are not good. Some things are terrible. But let's talk mostly about the good and seek to put out fires, not to fan the flames, if you know what I mean. That's to be, keep your tongue from evil. Use your tongue in ways that build trust, that put out fires, not that fans fires. Verse 11. Seek peace and pursue it. In Kosovo, there has been a horrible war, as you know, between the Muslims and the Serbian Christians. And it was the best way to describe it is horrible. The cross in those wars became a sign of violence against Muslims. And now the war is over, and they're trying to build a society with space for Serbs and for Kosovaris and Catholics, and could it be possible also space for evangelicals? Because the ministry of evangelical Christians during those wars has been very effective and fruitful in leading Muslims to come to faith in Christ. So you have these fellowships of believers in Kosovo who are from Muslim background but evangelical. Any space for them? So those are the sorts of questions. And how do you bring healing to a nation that's been so wounded in this sort of conflict? I was invited to come to Kosovo, for a peacemaking mission, to try to work at peacemaking concerns as a guest, an invitee. And my hosts went and met with leaders of the Muslim leaders, theologians in the university. And they said that David Shenk is coming into town and he loves to converse about peacemaking with Muslims, and he wrote a book with a Muslim, Badu Katalega, called A Muslim and a Christian in Dialogue. Would you consider having a public dialogue on peacemaking as a step toward nation building when he is in town? No, we wouldn't do that, because we really are concerned about the presence of evangelical Christians in our country. And that would seem to give credibility for them. So we wouldn't be interested in that. But they gave out a number of these books to these theologians in the department. And one of them got in touch with the head of the Evangelical Alliance. He said, I changed my mind. I would like to have a dialogue, but not at the university. Let's do it at a neutral place. And so that dialogue happened. And they advertised it all over the country, a dialogue on peacemaking, with pictures of this book. And so they rented the largest hall in town, in the country, which seated 600 people. It's a small country. And it was just packed out. People came from all over Kosovo for this dialogue, including, I was told, most if not all, of the key Muslim leaders, the chief Qadi and so forth. They were all there. And this went on for 2 hours. And of course, in my presentation, I sought to speak about the peace that is ours in Christ, and the way of the cross, and so forth. It was a very intense engagement, and very helpful, I felt. Then the next day came the press, and the press interviewed me, and the first question was, it was the local weekly news magazine, which is read all across Kosovo, and it's a Muslim magazine. The first question was, why are you committed to peacemaking? I said, it's because of Jesus. And so she said, I really don't want to talk about Jesus because this is a Muslim magazine. So the first question, why are you committed to peacemaking? I said, because of Jesus. And 90 minutes later, she closed up her notebook. She says, the whole interview has been about Jesus. I don't know if the Muslim editors of this magazine will permit this to be printed or not. They printed it. Center page, center spread. Double page center spread in that magazine. Who is Jesus and the peace he brings? And the whole nation read about this, you see, the peace of Jesus and the healing he brings. And growing out of that, the leader of the evangelical movement and the leaders of the Muslim movement began to have conversations together, pushing on forward about the peace that Jesus brings and the healing he offers to a wounded, broken people and broken nation, you know. And as I understand it, the long and short of it is that in the Constitution, there is now space for diversity, including evangelical Protestants, to be present within Kosovo, you see. seeking peace and pursue it. I had the greatest admiration for those who invited me to come to think creatively about ways in which to work at peacemaking in a very, very difficult situation, you see. We have to knock on the doors and seek to find doors that open to build bridges of peacemaking. Verse 12 speaks about prayer. We need to be a people of prayer. The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are attentive to their prayer. The face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Walk in prayer. This movement, dear brothers and sisters, of peacemaking and bearing faithful witness to Christ is beyond us. We need to flow in the power of the Holy Spirit. Be a people who walk in prayer and live righteously. Ah, my, to be Sermon on the Mount Christians is amazing. You know, to be Ten Commandment Christians is not amazing. All Muslims would agree with the Ten Commandments. Both Muslims and Christians agree about the Ten Commandments. But the Sermon on the Mount, love the enemy. Wow. Integrity, your yes is yes and your no is no. Very good. Giving to the poor. Woo. You know? Being peacemakers. Wow. You know, you read the Sermon on the Mount. This is revolutionary good news ethics. Being Sermon on the Mount Christians. Oh, 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 oh. It is surprising. Live righteously, he says. Live righteously.
Have you benefited from this teaching ministry? Have you found TVS videos helpful and relevant? Please consider supporting TVS with your prayers and financial gifts. For more information, please visit www.tvseminary.com.
Let's press on. Verse 13. Do good. Do good. Most Muslims never read the Bible, like we said this morning. But they do read the Bible of our lives. Doing good is a witness. It's a sign of the gospel and opens doors. Verse 14, don't be surprised about suffering. It comes our way. Suffering is part of the journey. Also verse 14, be bold. Don't be afraid. This Ahmed, who I'm writing a memoir with, says how that one day in Somalia, there was a court case, and he was invited as a witness. The whole court packed out, and the judge says, okay, swear in the Quran that you'll tell the truth. He says, I'm a follower of Jesus, the Messiah. I will not swear in the Quran. And the whole court, ooh. From that courtroom, my witness was heard all across the nation. Be bold. Be bold. Wisely bold. Be as harmless as doves, Jesus says, and as wise as serpents. Verse 15, which is my life motto. But in your heart, set apart Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an account, the answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect. Confess that Jesus is Lord. Be clear about that. Be ready, and I hope this seminar has helped to do that. Be equipped to respond to the questions that come. And our Muslim friends bring us very deep questions. We need to be ready to respond to those questions with clarity. Be equipped to respond and do it with gentleness and respect. I hope this seminar has been in that spirit. I think I mentioned to you in the opening session how when I was invited to London, to England, for a series of dialogues, and after the first evening in the Central London Mosque, 3-hour marathon, where I sought to confess Christ with all the clarity I knew how to, the next day the Muslim companion who was dialoguing with me said, last night we listened to the gospel with utmost respect. Do you know why? I said, why? He said, because you love and respect. If we are hostile, that builds walls. Confess Christ as Lord. Be ready to give account of the hope that you have with gentleness and respect. Verses 16 to 21. Rejoice in your salvation. Muslims sometimes comment that our worship sounds like we're having a party. And I say that's exactly right. We are having a party because we are transformed and forgiven by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. We have to sing when we get together. And it struck me when I was in Tehran at that Mahdi conference. Two wonderful days of sermon after sermon, there was no singing. An audience of between 1,000 and 4,000, a gathering, never one song. Those 2 days together. And then I went to the Assemblies of God Church in central Tehran. The place was packed out, people standing in the aisles, and they're singing, oh my, you think the roof was going to go off. Such joy. And the pastor spoke about the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the forgiveness we have in him and the yoke that he gives, which is so light and so easy. And he gave an invitation and people coming forward with tears streaming down their cheeks. You know, we rejoice in our salvation. Our hearts are filled with song. I remember when my mother died, just for example, in an air crash in East Africa. And I shared with a number of the Somalis with whom I was working, I'm so grateful to know I will meet her someday. What did you say? Yes, I will meet my mother someday in heaven. How do you know she's in heaven? Ah, because of Jesus. And I'm going there too. Wow. Rejoice in our salvation. Last night I had a wonderful conversation with my father. I thought your father lives in Tanzania. You're in Somalia. I mean, my Father in heaven. What? Your Father in heaven? Who's that? It's God Almighty, the creator of the heavens and the earth. He's my loving Heavenly Father. I had a wonderful conversation with him last evening. How'd you talk? In prayer, you know? Rejoice in your salvation. Bear witness to the salvation we have in Jesus. And be confident that Jesus has all authority. Verse 22. We will experience many challenges, but all authority is given to Jesus. Amen. Comments? And then we go to topic 20.
Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 10, 11. How to give to TVS Ministry. You may give online at efta.org/givenow. In the description place, write Russia Distance Learning, account number 24109-0150. Or make checks out to EFCA. Write on the check memo line, Russian Distance Learning, account number 24109-0150. Mail to EFCA Donor Services, 901 East 78th Street, Minneapolis, Minnesota, 55420-1300. Or send your gift through PayPal for tvs.gift@gmail.com.